Stanton? No. Okay. Let us now prove the result on towers and composites of unramified extension. So let L be a finite extension of our field K. Then we have the following. If you've got a tower K FL, so L is over F, F is over K, then L is unramified over K if and only if F is unramified over F, and F L is unramified over F, and F is unramified over K. The second statement is that if L is unramified over K and K1 is a finite extension of K, then L K1, the composite, is unramified over K1. And the third one is that if L1 and L2 are unramified over K, this is of course a misprint, so is the composite L1 and L2. So the first statement follows from these bounds. So you have the degrees of your extensions are at least degrees of extensions of residue fields. So if L is unramified over K, then the degree of L over K is actually equal to the degree of small l over small k. But the product of these 2 degrees is equal to the product of these 2 degrees. So this means that these products are equal because in the tower, degrees are multiplicative. And so from these inequalities, you get that if this is equality, then these 2 inequalities are also equalities. And conversely, of course. So the second one follows from the following fact, from theorem three. Suppose that L is equal to K of alpha, and G is a minimal polynomial of alpha with separable reduction. Then a minimal polynomial of alpha over K1 is a factor of G. And so its reduction to the residue field is also separable because it's a factor of a separable polynomial. So the third statement is also is of course a consequence of the first one and the second one. Okay. Next, we are going to show that unramified extension actually correspond bijectively to separable extensions of the residue field. The theorem is as follows. K is above. Let's fix the embedding inside the inside the the algebraic closure. Then for every finite extension L, OL is the integral closure of our ring of integers, and let OK bar be the integral closure of OK inside K bar. For any L, you have a homomorphism of OK bar, so the restriction of OL has kernel pi L. And then this map, which maps OL to its image under such a homomorphism, is a bijection between unramified extensions of K and separable extension of the extensions of the residue field. To prove this statement, let's use theorem three, which implies that every finite separable extension of the residue field is an image of OL for some unramified extension L. So what we need to prove to establish theorem 4 is the uniqueness of such an extension. So first of all, if F1 is a sub-extension of F2 and both are unramified, then the corresponding fields phi of O F1 and phi of O F2, well, you have an obvious inclusion, first of all. And this inclusion cannot actually be an identity. It is impossible for this inclusion to not be strict. Is this clear? Let's talk a little bit about this one. So assume that F1 lies in some larger field and both fields are unramified. Can it happen that the residue fields of these two fields are actually equal?
Сейчас, я вот не понимаю формулировку теоремы. Что это за фи? Фи зависит от L или фи одно для всех?
Да, фи зависит от L.
И тогда снизу там фи разные для F1 и F2.
Ну, понятно, it is of course clear that if F2 is larger than F1, then you can choose phi for F2, and it will also be a suitable phi for F1, right?
Okay.
So this map is basically a map into the residue field and nothing more. Okay, so once again, suppose that you have two unramified extensions, one lies inside another, and the residue fields of these extensions are equal. Can this happen? Well, this is actually impossible because if the residue fields are equal, then the degree of one over another is equal to one, but this extension F2 over F1 is unramified, of course. So the degree of F2 over F1 is equal to the degree of the residue fields, of extension of residue fields. So if the fields are not equal, then the corresponding residue fields are not equal. So assume that we have two different fields, L1 and L2, generated by alphas. And let us take a composite of these two unramified fields, L1, L2, which is denoted by L. And it is, of course, equal to L2 of alpha 1, and this is L1 of alpha 2. So using theorem 3, we see that phi OL is equal to phi L2 phi of alpha 1, which is equal to the residue field of K of phi of alpha 1 and phi of alpha 2. And this is a product, or the composite, if you want, of the corresponding residue fields. So the composite of our fields has a residue field, which is a composite of residue fields of L1 and L2. So if the residue fields of L1 and L2 are equal, then the residue field of L is equal, for example, to the residue field of L1. And this is impossible by the previous consideration if the inclusion L1 inside L is strict. This means that L1 is actually equal to L, and so L1 and L2 are equal to each other. So using this result, you can, for example, show that finite unramified extension of extensions of QP correspond bijectively to finite extensions of the simple finite field. And the maximal unramified extension is equal to the infinite cyclotomic extension of degree p to the infinity minus one. That is, you take QP of zeta p to the n minus one, the following cyclotomic periodic field, and you take a limit of this field as n goes to infinity. This is an inductive limit in this case. Okay, so this is what can we do, what we can do with unramified extensions. Let us talk a little bit about the diametrically opposed notion, the totally ramified extensions. Using previous notations, the field is called totally ramified if its inert degree is equal to one. This means that all the degree of your field comes from the ramification. It turns out that these two cases are not only diametrically opposed, they are also complement each other. So we are going to show the following statement. Assume that you have a finite extension of your field K, and let L sub U be the composite of all subfields L, which are unramified over K. Then L sub U is also unramified over K, and L is totally ramified over LU. This is...
Excuse me, what is a composite?
Composite is the least field that contains all these fields. So you take all the unramified extensions, and you take a field that contains all of them. So you basically can take all the generators of your unramified subfields, take them together, and generate an extension using these elements. Okay. So.
Okay. So it's like
what?
Some extensions with inclusions. It's some extension with inclusions. Of elements of LU, fusions of L.
You have a larger field L that contains all the fields I'm talking
about. So we can intersect just the
Not intersect, but kind of take union of this field.
Take union
generate the field using this union. Okay. That's it precisely. Okay, so the first statement that LU is unramified, it follows from the previous proposition because a composite of unramified extensions is also unramified. And the second one about the total ramification, suppose that L is not totally ramified over LU, then the extension L over LU has degree larger than one. This means that there is an unramified sub-extension L sharp of L, such that L sharp is equal to L, of course. But this is impossible because then L sharp will be a sub-extension of LU, but L sharp over LU will have degree greater than one, which is a contradiction. Okay. Now, suppose that L is a finite extension. We are going to say that it is tamely ramified По-русски это ручное ветвление, то есть разветвлено ручным способом. If the characteristic of the residue field, characteristic of L or of K, it's the same, does not divide the ramification index. Okay, so if it does divide the ramification index, we say that L over K is strongly or wildly ramified, то есть сильно или дико. So now we are going to describe all totally and tamely ramified extensions. First of all, we are going to prove the following theorem. Suppose that L is totally ramified over K, and let pi be a uniformizing element. Then pi is root of some Eisenstein polynomial that is a polynomial of this form, x to the e plus some other terms, and all the coefficients besides the first one lie in our maximal ideal, and the last coefficient lies in the maximal ideal, but not in its square. So any totally ramified extension is generated by root of Eisenstein polynomial, and conversely, such a polynomial is always reducible, and its root generates a totally ramified extension of degree e. Okay, so how to prove this? For the first part, all the conjugates of our uniformizing element have the same absolute value due to uniqueness of norm extension. So coefficients of the minimal polynomial of uniformizing element are symmetric polynomials of conjugates. So they all lie in the intersection of our larger ideal with the smaller ring of integers, which is just mk. So all the coefficients of the minimal polynomial of uniformizing element lie in the ideal of the smaller field. And now we need to show that the constant term does not lie in the square of this ideal. But this is obvious because up to a sign, this constant term is the product of all conjugates. And there are E conjugates. And so the absolute value of A0 is equal to the absolute value of pi to the E, which is the same as the absolute value of pi sub K, which was needed. Okay, conversely, all Eisenstein polynomials are reducible. I think that all the listeners here know how to prove that Eisenstein polynomial is reducible. And if beta is the root of such a polynomial, then using the same argument as above, we see that the absolute value of b to the e is equal to the absolute value of the uniformizing element of k. So beta is a uniformizer in k of beta, and the degree of k of beta, which is equal to e, is actually equal to the ramification index due to this identity, which means that the field generated by beta is indeed a totally ramified field. So let us characterize tamely ramified extensions. So let L be a totally ramified extension over K. Then there is a uniformizer pi such that capital pi to the E is equal to the small pi for some uniformizing element of K. And conversely, suppose suppose that A is an element of our ring O sub K, and E is a positive integer that is not divisible by a characteristic of the residue field. Then any root of the equation x to the e is equal to a generates a tamely ramified extension of k, and this extension is completely ramified if the valuation of a and e are coprime. Okay, so first of all, let us prove the second part. If f of x is equal to x to the e x to the e minus a, and a is in O sub k, p does not divide e, then we have a is p to the r multiplied by some unit, r is an integer, some integer. And then the corresponding extension is contained in this field, k of zeta e, u to the 1 over e, and pi to the 1 over e. Zeta e is, of course, its root of unity. So the extension generated by everything besides the root of uniformizer is, of course, unramified. So pi is prime in O sub f. And the extension f of p to the 1 over e is totally and tamely ramified. So f and all its subfields are tamely ramified. Wait, not f, but this thing, k of these three elements is totally, this extension is totally and tamely ramified over f. So if the if the valuation of a is coprime to e, then there are integers s and t such that se plus tr is equal to 1. And so you can set beta to be alpha t pi to the s, alpha to the t, pi to the s. And here alpha is root of our polynomial. And beta to the e will be alpha to the te multiplied by p to the se. And the valuation of alpha to the te will be the valuation of a to the t, which is tr. And so you get tr plus se, and the valuation of b to the e is equal to 1. And the ramification index of the corresponding field is at least e. So it is actually equal to e because the degree of the field is equal to e. So what do we need to prove now is that any totally tamely ramified extension is generated by the root of this equation, x to the e minus p minus pi, where e is the ramification index and pi is a uniformizer. Okay, to prove this, let us prove the following lemma. So we have our e, not divisible by p. We have a finite, totally ramified extension of k. We have a uniformizing element in OK and beta in L, such that the norm of b of beta to the e is equal to the norm of pi zero. So then there is a uniformizing element pi, such that one of the roots of this polynomial that we are looking for is contained in k of beta. Okay, how do we prove such a statement? Well, beta to the e is equal to our uniformizer multiplied by some unit from the greater from the greater field, and the extension is totally ramified, so the residue field is the same for L and K, and so there is a unit from K which is congruent to U modulo P0, and so you can set pi is equal to P0 U0, and you get beta to the E is equal to pi plus pi x for some x congruent to P0, congruent to zero modulo P0. And so you get the following inequality. So the norm of beta to the E minus pi is less than the norm of pi. What can we conclude from this? Well, if f of x is our polynomial x to the e minus pi, and alpha I are the roots of this polynomial, then f of beta, which is this thing, is equal to the product of all I, beta minus alpha I. And the norm of alpha I is, of course, trivially the same as the norm of beta. So from this inequality, which is, well, the norm of pi is equal to the norm of beta to the e, we see that for at least one I, we have this, the norm of beta minus alpha I is less than the norm of alpha I. On the other hand, due to coprimality of E and P, the derivative of our polynomial is equal to E x to the E minus one, and E does not affect the norm. So the derivative at alpha I is equal to the norm of alpha I to the E minus one, which is the same as the following product over all J, not equal to I, alpha I minus alpha j taken with the norm. Okay, so what does this mean? This means that the absolute value of alpha I minus alpha j is equal to the absolute value of alpha I for all j not equal to I. But from this inequality, we see that beta is closer to alpha I than any of the conjugates of alpha I. So Krasner's lemma here implies that K, this should be alpha I, of course, K alpha I lies inside K of beta, which concludes the proof. Any questions on this one? Please. If not, so now we are ready to prove theorem six. You just need to take beta to be capital pi here, because, yeah, so you take any uniformizer, and the norm of this uniformizer is equal to what you need it to be equal. And then the corresponding field lies inside your field. And this concludes the proof. Okay, so this characterizes all the tamely ramified extensions. And you can show the proposition that is completely analogous to propositions two and three. So you can take composites and powers of unramified extensions. And if you take the composite of all tamely ramified sub extensions of a finite extension L over K, then this composite of all tamely ramified sub extensions is also tamely ramified. And also L over this maximal tamely ramified extension is of course totally ramified, because you can take unramified extensions and nothing will change. And also this degree L over LT is a power of characteristic. So any extension is not only a tower of unramified and totally ramified extension, but also a tower of unramified, totally ramified, but tamely ramified, and then wildly ramified with degree or which is a power of characteristic of the of the residue field. Okay, and the last result for today is the following fact. If you take any finite extension of Q sub P, then for any n, there are only finitely many extensions of K of degree n. We already seen this phenomenon for QP and quadratic extensions, but this is, of course, a much more general result. Okay. So, how do we prove such a theorem? Well, there is only one unramified extension of a given degree, because there is only one extension of a finite field of a given degree. Every extension is tower of unramified and completely ramified extension. So it's enough to show that there is only a finite number of totally ramified extensions of a given degree, right? So such extensions are generated by roots of Eisenstein equations. And you can write these Eisenstein polynomials as follows. These coefficients are multiplied by pi and assumed to lie in O sub k. And the last coefficient is also multiplied by pi, but it lies in the group of units. Okay, but the direct product O sub k times O sub k times and so on times the group of units is, of course, compact. This is because the ring of periodic integers is compact, and so every finite extension of the ring of periodic integers is also compact. I mean, every free module of finite rank is also compact. Okay, every point of this space gives us a bounded number of extensions of degree E. And Krasner's lemma implies that any point from some neighborhood of such a point defines the same extension. This is the same reasoning as the first corollary. So this means that the extension is defined not only by a point, but by a neighborhood of a point. But this space is compact. So you can choose a finite subcover, and it will give you all the possible extensions of degree E. Okay, so you get a finitely many extensions, and from this you deduce that there are only finitely many extensions of a given degree of a given extension of periodic numbers. So this sort of arguments is actually very typical in this area, and in next lectures we will see more examples of such reasoning using compactness and some other topological properties of periodic numbers and related objects. Okay, that's all for today. See you at the seminar. Here is Kurt Hensel. the scientists that invented the periodic numbers. Thank you very much for your attentions. Maybe there are any questions about the contents of the lecture. If not, I will stop the recording.